I like your shoes. Okay, welcome to our second session of the last day. Our first talk is by Roberto Lalli, and the title is up there, so.
Thanks very much for the presentation. Thanks for the organization. And I'm going to talk about the entry of quantum theory at the Bell Telephone Laboratories, also known as Bell Labs. As you well know, the Bell Telephone Laboratories have been one of the most successful industrial research settings for what concerns the new production of knowledge in physics. I just mentioned that as many as seven research achievements produced at the Bell Lab gained the Nobel Prize in Physics to the scientists who pursued them. This set of firsts led many historians of physics, notably Lillian Odison, to explore the entry of the quantum theory, in particular the quantum theory of solids, at the Bell Labs, and an example of the application of new theoretical advances. And Odison described this entry in two different phases. The first phase was actually a retraining of the staff who was already working at the Bell Labs or the Western Engineering, Western Electric Engineering Department, and went from the 1920s, roughly 1920 to 1936. Well, there was a second phase that began with the hiring of recent PhDs in physics that were well trained in quantum mechanics and could actually be able to apply later the theory to the industrial needs of the firm. Odison argues that the first phase was unsuccessful. Essentially, the physicists or the scientists working at the Bell Labs were unable to, they were not trained enough to use the theory for industrial application. And whether this is, interpretation is true or not, I think that the first phase is, however, very interesting for an historical perspective because it could give us some ideas of the way new knowledge that it produced in one place is transferred to another place, in which this knowledge should be possibly applied to some technological artifacts. I know that the best way to do that is actually to look at the way in which the theoretical tools travels and how in these travels they get transformed. But I'm not doing this in the present talk. I will give another perspective that could be a way to ample the discussion, even because in this period, as Odison also stressed, the theoretical tools were very difficult to apply to specific problems. Poof. So let me clarify that although the Bell Telephone Laboratories were established as an independent research and development subsidiary of the Bell system only in 1925, for what concerns the topic of metop and for many other respects, we can consider the Bell Labs as the direct continuation of the research that was being done at the engineering department of the Western Electric Company. And enough research was already established at the engineering department well before World War I. In 1911, a research branch was established under the direction of Colpitz, but the most important researcher in this context was Harold Arnold, around which a small group of researchers began working on basic research on physics and chemistry not related to short-term needs. They were beginning to do basic research without a specific application in mind, that foreseeable application in mind. In the context of the research group, one physicist played a major role in the transfer of new knowledge within the engineering department and later Bell Labs. It is Carl K. Darrow, whose trajectory in the history of physics is arguably unique. After a degree, a PhD with Millikan in 1917, he entered the Bell Labs in the research branch of the engineering department during World War I. But soon after the war, his skills and his particular activity were dismissed. And so there was no way to keep Darrow doing the work he was doing during World War I. But Arnold asked Darrow to stay at the engineering department in a different position that was not related at all with the research activities. His role was was so unique that it's very difficult to define what in a single way the complexity of his action within the engineering department. And I'm not the only one to find it difficult. It was defined the intelligencer to the community at the laboratory. Otherson called him synthesizers of new ideas. Others replied that it was actually an interpreter. While each of these terms is able to picture something of the complexity of activities, none of them is able to represent it all. So we can look at what it actually did. At the beginning, it was asked to organize the unpublished literature of the engineering department, the scientific engineer memoranda of the research staff. But shortly, his role became much more complex than just that. Okay. In October 1919, 23 members of the research department, or the engineering department, established a society, a real society called the Colloquium, which was established, and I quote, for the general purpose of enabling its members to keep in touch with recent thought and experiment in physics and allied sciences. This was a very stable and structured enterprise. They gathered two evenings per month for more than 20 years, till 1942, actually till the United States entered World War II. They had an executive committee formed by one president, one vice president, and one secretary. The only members of the American Mathematical Society, American Chemical Society, American Physical Society could be admitted, and only 5 members per year. In particular, it is centered that there was no formal institutional commitment of the directors to this endeavor. It seems that there was an effort freely made by the researchers to gain new knowledge. And it's very plausible that this activity was born to keep in touch with the recent theoretical advancement in quantum theory. And the topics of the first season of the colloquium confirmed this idea, because the first talk was the present status of theoretical physics, and a lot of topics concerned the theoretical aspect of quantum physics that didn't seem to have any foreseeable application to industrial needs of the Bell system. Since Darrow didn't do actually any research work, he was the right person to organize all the activity of the colloquium, and so he became the secretary of the colloquium from its establishment till for a number of years, probably till the mid-1930s, when the secretary became Walter Brattain. However, I will focus today on the third of his activity, that was to write typed reports of new recent advances. He had the freedom to travel a lot during summers. He went to European university, in particular in Germany and in UK. He regularly attended the American Physical Society meetings and went to many universities and had many relationships with academic physicists. So his role was to write abstracts and reviews of the recent advancement that the scientists working in the engineering department could not read personally because they didn't have time to do so. Shortly, this activity became his major activity, and he began writing regularly on the quarterly journal of the Bell system, that was the Bell System Technical Journal. And as the introduction to the first papers of the series stresses, this was a way to make this useful reviews written by Darrow available to a broader audience, all the research staff of the BED system and the broader readership of the journal, because the journal was also sent to many universities for free, and this was a way to keep students updated of new knowledge, Darrow's reports. This, I found Darrow's reviews particularly useful for an historical investigation because Darrow was not only trying to summarize knowledge that was produced as it were, but he interpreted it. He tried to give sense of the new advances for himself and for his readers. So I will now, I'm now going to give an overview of how his approach changes together with the changes of the quantum theoretical, the theoretical advancement in quantum theory. And after I will try to comment these advances with respect to Darrow's epistemological position and Darrow's view of the unity of physics and of the role of physics in the Bell Labs and the broader community. So during from 1923 to 1926, of course, the main topics of his reviews was the evolution of the quantum, the old, what is now called the old quantum theory. He started from the new experimental investigation, what the new experimental findings meant, how they were interpreted, but he also tried to make sense of conceptual problem. What particularly stressed him was the relationship, the complex relationship between the corpuscular and wave description of light. When he first addressed the problem in wave quanta in the paper written in 1925, he clearly expressed his epistemological position. According to him, experiments have priority over theory, and so even though a theory seemed absurd, one should try to believe it up to a certain point. And after representing the phenomena that were interpreted as a confirmation of the quantum theory, the corpuscular description of light, he stressed that some phenomena, the ones that he described, occur as if radiant energy of the frequency ni were concentrated into packets or units of corpuscle of energy amounted to h ni. But he stressed that one should never forget that the theory, however, was absurd in a certain sense. It was related to another theory of light, the wave theory, in not simple or trivial manner. And so the physicist, in particular the experimental physicist, should never forget the words as if. But at the end of the paper, after he described all the experimental finds who led to believe that the light behaved as if it was made of corpuscles, he said that what is required now in order to build the relationship between wave and quanta of light was a modification, indeed a revolutionary extension of the art of thinking. So at this point, he was asking for a sort of revolution of the way physicists look at the microscopic world. 1 year later, he published The Introduction of Contemporary Physics. It was a collection of the papers he had already written for the BED System Technical Journal. And he, in this, the prolegomena, he made it very clear which were his epistemological position. First of all, theorizing was just a model building activity. And so the scientists believe that the simple models that govern simple phenomena also govern complex phenomena is just an act of fate. And this act of fate was actually not bad because it could lead to advancement of knowledge, but one should not forget that each model has on its own validity only within the range of phenomena that it was designed to imitate. What he was asking for was just to not give too much metaphysical content to the theoretical descriptions. And he explicitly asked not to consider such exceeding properties, the one that describe more complex phenomena as physical realities, it used different, it was acceptable to use different models of the same entity in different, same supposed entity in different situations. And so in this sense, he made sense of the quanta corpuscular description of light in different contexts. But while his book was in press, enormous advances in quantum theory was produced, and he had to make sense of the new matrix and wave mechanics. And his reception of these two different approach to the quantum world were similar to others of this generation. He read with anxiety the Dreimannerarbeit, while he was very happy, was relieved by Schrödinger's paper, Schrödinger's approach. According to him, wave mechanics seemed, and I quote, to promise a fulfillment of the long baffled and suppressible desire of those physicists, including him, who yearned for continuity in their images of science. What made the Schrödinger wave mechanic, the brilliant Schrödinger wave mechanic, so acceptable to him was the fact that it was possible to present it in a very visualizable way. And in fact, he was very bold. He said that this approach of presentation differed completely from those followed by Schrödinger. The brilliant was not completely, but there were important differences. And it was even so bolder to say that this method of exposition was the one which Schrödinger actually meant when he wrote, this is Schrödinger, I had originally intention of establishing the new formulation of the quantum conditions in the more visualizable and schaulich way, but prefer the natural mathematical form because it makes the sense clearer. So, the Anschaulich was an important notion that led to many philosophical disagreements within the protagonists of wave mechanics. I'm not going to address that, it was already addressed today before giving new perspectives. What I'm going to see today and how Darrow interpreted Anschaulich and how that for him were similar to Schrödinger's approach. It started from a visualizable known vibratory processes. It started from three familiar samples of stationary wave patterns that were well known to probably all this readership and, of course, to the physicists and the engineers working at the Bell Labs at this point. There were the stretched string, the tensor membrane, and ball of fluid confined in a spherical shell, that the three representing the stationary waves in different dimensions, one and two and three special dimensions. Of course, the first two was very simple to visualize because psi was just a displacement perpendicular to the equilibrium positions that that could travel through the wave equation. The third, however, didn't renounce to give a suggestion for visualizing also the third example, the three-dimensional examples, that actually was the one that was more similar to the atom model, the wave mechanical atom model of the hydrogen atom. And so he suggested to see the wave description of the ball of fluid as a rarefaction and condensation of the fluid. After analyzed these three problems, giving some boundary conditions, special boundary conditions, in particular coordinates, and showed how this condition actually determined rigorously the allowed frequencies, the eigenfrequencies, and even so the eigenfunction. And from this analysis, this analysis led to the investigations of wave mechanics, the presentation of wave mechanics. Now I stress simply that he wrote the wave equations, the wave equation for mechanical vibratory processes. The U squared term in the wave equation is simply the velocity. It's of course always positive, the U squared. But in wave mechanical description, the term U squared could be variable dependent on the coordinates or even negative. And so it was known that to put some pictures to mathematical terms without any clear physical meaning could be dangerous, but he didn't renounce to do that. He gave an example of a squared that could be negative in function of x in one dimension. Of course, psi was the second dimension, but was the wave. And from that, he was able to translate the description of this monodimensional case to the description of the harmonic oscillator, just changing some terms. What was important to this discussion, didn't renounce to see the u squared as something that could be understood as a velocity, and he called this an imaginary wave speed. This means that the wave mechanical description of the harmonic oscillator and the hydrogen atom could be described as an imaginary string or imaginary fluids that actually move in space in a way that could be pictured as if they were mechanically vibratory system. And he was very confident in this kind of presentation and in the wave mechanics because, as this sentence shows, the vibrating imaginary fluid will furnish the customary symbolism for expressing the data of experiment for some years to come. So he thought that wave mechanics was completely superior, of course, to metric mechanics, but who had the promise to be the right theory of the quantum world, the atomic processes, because it was summarized. And this was also clear in this sentence. The success of the theory with respect to competitor description depended on the fact that it was unrivaled as a device for picturing the radiation process. And so we can deduce that Anschaulichkeit for him was just a way to say that one could build a space-time image of wave mechanics solutions by relating the wave mechanical formalism to familiar phenomena that was very known and was mechanical description was also well known. But he later had to cope with the new advances in which matrix mechanics and wave mechanics were just seen as a part of the same theory, and it had to translate these for the scientists who were not familiar with the new advances. Moreover, his reviews were published in different venues, so had even broader readership. One of his works was also translated in Germany with the introduction of Schrödinger. All his new way of picturing the new advances were summarized, were condensed in the article Elementary Notions of Quantum Mechanics that was published in Reviews of Modern Physics in 1934. He, again, was not a simple summarizer. He took a strong stance against the way in which the quantum mechanics was presented by the leaders of the field and in textbooks. He expressed his distaste for the trend toward perfect abstractions, which for several years had been dominant in quantum mechanics, because he belonged to the group of scientists who craved to retain for as long as possible, as many as possible, of the links with the past. Now, in this new big reviews, of course, he talked about the major advances, wave mechanics, matrix algebra, quantum operators. He renounced to visualizable processes to understand them. He even recognized that it was impossible to make a picture of the terms. But he didn't touch much the interpretational problem. For what he writes, it's pretty clear that he followed a kind of ensemble statistical interpretation of quantum mechanics. But this is not important because its aim is not to give arguments for a certain interpretation. Well, his aim was to show that the new theory had firm historical roots and was not more than an elaboration of well-established idea, even though what was happening with an Hamiltonian could be understood as particularly strange. So his aim was to challenge in a very explicit way the revolutionary narrative by providing instead an evolutionary treatment. In the Renaissance of Physics, that was the last work in which he addressed this problem in 1936, In the introduction, he repeated his arguments. He was not now so much interested in giving the presentation of quantum mechanics, but he stressed again which were his philosophical position as his view of physics, or the evolution of physics. He stressed again that what is happening is not a revolution in modern physics, and it's a tremendously rapid evolution. We can see a challenge, a contrast between a kind of presentation of quantum mechanical advances and a way to try to represent them in a very different way from people who was receiving the advancement, was not actually involved in them. So he stressed the historical continuity of physics, but he had to say which were the thing that stayed firm in the evolution of physics. And for him, one has to look just at the tools. There were material tools as a part in experimental activities, but there were also theoretical tools, and these tools don't change in a sudden manner. So if one looks at the tools, is able to give a very straightforward evolution, and even if it is rapid, the Hamiltonian is always an Hamiltonian, even though it is it can be used in a way that not simple understanding from a different previous perspective. He had to give some example. Unfortunately, he didn't go too much in very technical problems, but he again stressed the importance of the wave particle duality, but in a different way. In this way, the fact the wave and particle description like matter continued to be used for different phenomena in the same moment, for him was the proof that the tools were so successful that there was no way to get rid of any of them. Now I will conclude with the questions I made at the beginning. What this kind of presentation by Darrow can tell us about the industrial research environment, or even the broader environment to which his reviews were addressed. Darrow worked at the engineering department, the Bell Labs, that were both, and even the Bell Labs even more, multidisciplinary environment in which physicists, chemists, engineers, all worked together often with very goal-oriented practices. In this kind of environment, the boundaries between disciplinary fields were very blurred and often disappeared, in particular between basic and applied research that was not completely clear within the organization. The labs were where one could draw a clear boundary. And for some of the people working them, this was a major issue, because for Darrow, the engineer was nothing. Was nothing but an applied physicist. And the applied physicist and the pure physicist for him made exactly the same thing. Both modified the nature. The pure physicist for understanding nature, the applied physicist for user to serve people, but essentially they do the same thing. He tried to show the technological environment, to promote the technological environment as the way to cancel the possible boundaries between disciplinary fields or subdisciplinary fields. And this was pretty similar to what, in a sense, Toby described as the American ideology of national science that was promoted by leading scientists in the period, in the interwar period, in particular by Millikan, for what interests us, that had many connections with the Bell Labs. They were trying to promote a view of pure science as the basic and the basic build block of applied science. One could not hope to produce new technological artifacts without funding and without looking at the basic science. And the Bell Labs seemed to endorse this view in a number of ways. First of all, the Bell Labs were one of the few firms in the United States which actually funded the activity of the National Research Councils. That was one of the ways Millikan was promoting this view to industries. And also because continue to maintain some branches, some groups devoted to basic research. And in this context, what was particularly challenging was the promotion of the new theory as a new revolution that actually could be understood by a few people, leaving all the others outside this small group that was making the revolutions. So they were trying to build a narrative of physics as one of the same community in which pure and applied physicists could talk, and even maybe engineers. And Darrow was very concerned about the breaking of this community in different sub-communities since that period. And this, against this compartmentalization of physics, he built his view of the new advances of quantum mechanics. And in this case, we can understand, after the revolutionary narrative was built, why he changed completely his initial view about the needs for a revolutionary change of the art of thinking to a very conservative view in which the revolutionary elements of the theory should be downplayed in order to keep the community unified. Thanks for the attention.
Okay, we've got about 12 minutes for questions. Kenji.
Thank you very much for the very interesting talk. My question is, could you talk a little bit more about the colloquium? Is it correct to understand that was the kind of the main community to which Darrow was, that was a group of people with whom Darrow was discussing or talking about the new quantum mechanics or his ideas about science? And if that's the case, then what kind of interaction was there and how that group was organized? What was that group dynamics compared to as a group of physicists in other centers of physics, like Copenhagen and so on.
There is not a simple answer. The colloquium evolved with time. It lasted 23 years. At the beginning, the structure of the colloquium was just that each of the members should prepare a review of new advances to present to the others. But the colloquium grew enormously, even though with just 5 new members per year. And so at a certain point, there were many member of the academy that were invited, even Schrödinger, even Wigner, and so on. It lasted in 1942. Probably it changed a little bit after the Second World War, but there were, I don't know if I'm replying your question. The structure of the colloquium changed and became a very big society in which a lot of physicists, and not only physicists, entered of the Bell Labs, but which was open in the sense that the physicists from outside came to give reports of their recent progress. So this is maybe a part of the response, but maybe didn't get.
Okay, so it's not like a small group of intimate discussions, it's more like more formal and higher.
No, it grew. At the beginning, maybe one can see this small group, but after 5 years, it was much bigger.
Okay.
I mean bigger, 60, and after became 130 in 1934. Grew enormously. At the end, there were, if they continue to keep about almost 200 people, so.
Martin?
Yep. Thanks for the great talk. My question goes along the same lines. Could you say a little bit more about the problems which are actually discussed in the colloquium, and then also in Darrow's review articles? And maybe, if that's not too much to ask, to compare this with sort of textbook accounts like Sommerfeld's Atombau and so on. Is there a particular kind of problem which interests the people at Bell Labs, or are they sort of taking a big swoop at everything?
The documents tell me, there was no focus. At the beginning, I have the strong impression that the problem was to understand the quantum theoretical development. And there might be some kind of idea of the way in which it was applied. But how the colloquium evolved was just to go in any direction, because we have Robertson giving a talk on the expanding universe that could be really not useful for any possible application of the Bell Labs. So what I see is just people that were, for intellectual curiosity, for possible application, try to keep in touch with what they consider. At the beginning, each member had to choose what he preferred as the main topic. As a matter of fact, the topics were the atomic theory, actually, at the first year, 1919. I mean, the Bohr's theory, the molecular, how to apply the molecular theory. Okay, there were much interest in these new projects. But as soon as new theoretical advances were proposed, they were very open to different approach. As far as the differences between textbooks, I see in this case, much less technical work, as this is the first part. There was no way to say that this was a textbook. This was a way to convey in a rapid manner the new advances to people who were not familiar. So I think I see a very strong difference with Somerset Booth, for example, or other possible textbook of the period.
Talk about similar problems then, if they're talking about atomic structure.
Yeah, sure. Just in a different way, at least as far as the published reviews could say.
All right, Michelle?
So as you know, like my former grad student, like Joe Martin, like worked on Darrow, but on in a slightly later period, right, in the late 40s, with the formation of the division of solid state physics, where Van Vleck is complaining about the balkanization of physics. And I thought that Darrow was actually sort of helping like this division along. And I wonder how that relates to his earlier concerns about keeping the community together.
Yeah. No, I mean, I have a different interpretation of this. I mean, what actually, let me say that this is for secondary literature, because I don't have the documents of the period by Darrow. But what I see, there was actually a way to keep the industrial physicists within the American Physical Society, so to maintain the, it was trying not to separate, it was trying to unify. It was opposed to the industrial physicists creating a different community, and so together, even though talking to different things, and was also a way to, it tried to avoid a further dispersion by creating just the solid state community, not the community of metallurgists or so on. So it actually, I see a certain similarity. It tried to keep the community together. The community was growing enormously, and so were industrial physicists that were now very interested in solid state, that now was a very clear field of studying where they actually built a community, but this tried to keep them together. And many letters, you see, many actions as a secretary of the American Physical Society, he stressed that everybody should be able to understand the lectures. I see a similarity in that.
Oh, look at that. I wrote my own name. We're taught, from Kevles's nice book, American Physicists, that the distinction between pure and applied science only comes after World War II, when the NSF is sort of first founded. So I'm wondering if that's your own terminology, or if there's really some important distinction between pure and applied that's already happening with Darrow pre-World War II.
I mean, this was the terminology used by Darrow.
Really? Okay.
Okay. See, he said pure physicist, applied physicist, engineer. We had a discussion even
the decision goes way back to the 19th century.
Si, si.
Okay.
Well, I actually have a few articles there. And can you start referring to that also in the industry?
Well, I read it like 12 years ago. So.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Thanks, historians. Yes.
So my question is also terminological. You used the expression model building for Darrow
referring to the practice of theoretical physical physics in general. Is that your term, or does Darrow actually uses it? Does he use the term model?
It's very clear. The theorist should only build models. And that, no, it's really Darrow's term. And I try to cover Darrow's term and to use the term in which the way he used them.
How early is that? Is that in the 20s or?
Well, 26. I mean, he used the model in, he didn't talk with epistemological view in the reviews, but in the book, yes. In the Prolegomena, he wrote a lot about the theorizing, yeah. I mean, he was a very nice thinker. I mean, it's a very, very particular view, but I don't think that he had a coherent philosophical perspective. Nancy Cartwright told that he was, he had this kind of perspective. It was like a reflex of a broader American view to address quantum theoretical evolution. I don't see that it was just a reflex of this broader view. It was quite something particular. But also because it was a very strange role, so.
Clayton?
I was wondering, sort of a two-part question. Did Darrow take an active role in the hiring? And was he involved? It's interesting that someone at Bell was able to get, and Western Electric before, was able to find corporate support for hiring what fairly early, I gather, was quite a capable community of physicists and others. What was Darrow's role in that?
As far as I know, no, he had no particular role. There were people, Kelly, the director of research, had a very good and clear idea in mind of the importance of solid state physics done with the quantum mechanical approach. He didn't know much about that, but he had clear that they should look for this. So I think that Darrow didn't have any actual role in this part of the Bell Labs organization. But I could be wrong because I just don't have enough material to say that. I didn't see anything about his role in the organization. He was quite isolated. I mean, he had connection very much with all the other physicists. So in informal ways, he could have been a certain role. Maybe with Davison, they shared the same room, just in the period in which Davison was working. But we could say nothing about what they actually discussed. They discussed probably quantum theory, but.
Wait, Aaron?
Yeah, so I thought this was really interesting. I'm curious, firstly, about the ideological connection. I wonder if you found explicit documents within the organization saying, like, yes, you know, this is, we have this ideology of bringing pure and applied together at the institutional, because you say Bell Labs supported this argument about American science, which is tied into, you know, for example, much earlier 19th century debates about how science can't be elitist, it has to be accessible to the masses, that because we're America. You know, so is this an extension of this longer running debate about the establishment of these sorts of things in the United States? And sort of to clarify that, and building off of Clayton's question, were these physicists who were hired at this stage, pre-war, were they hired as PhD physicists but then set to work on very engineering-based problems, or were they also allowed or encouraged to do a research of their own? Because I know this was a something of an issue when IBM started hiring physicists, or you can compare to contemporary cases where financial firms hire lots of PhDs in physics, but they don't pay them to spend any time doing physics research. So if you could talk about sort of this the level of institutional commitment, the amount of actual work that could be considered theoretical physics or whatever done in the institution.
Well, probably somebody in this room could say some more precise things about that. So, well, I mean, as for the first questions, I don't have any documents. I saw that there was a strong connection between the Millikan and the Bell Labs in many different ways. Not last, the first president was a very close friend of Millikan. He studied with him, and also Arnold was a Millikan students, so they were very strong intellectual and not only also programmatic connection in a certain way. So I see this kind of connection very strong, and Millikan was really pushing for that period for recognition of the importance of pure science, and in particular for funds. And the Bell Labs were supporting it, this without doubts, without doubts for what concerns the funds. There is no, I mean, I don't have no documents, direct documents about that, but I think that we're not against that. I mean, there were three, four maybe industrial settings who gave funds to the National Research Council at that period. And the Bell Labs was one of them. So it was committed to basic research. For the other question, I don't think that they hired people to do at the time before the war some research of their own. Things completely changed during First World War because there were a more stronger connection with the academic physicists. I think because they had to hire much more people in order to cope with the military needs because they were working with the army and the navy, and they did Darrow work and there. Davison worked and was hired at the same period. And a lot of younger physicists were added in that period to also theoretical work. And after they had to reorganize the thing, for example, Davison was given a certain degree of freedom, but a certain degree of freedom was not, it was probably just an exception. Documents said it was one between 10, so there were a very small group that was given a certain limit, but it was between the negotiation in order to keep them at the engineering department. This is what I see, understand of this process.
Okay, we've got a. Sorry, Clayton. We'll pick up this conversation at lunchtime. Sorry, Christiane as well. Let's thank Roberto one more time. And we welcome to the stage now, Mr.